Hi all, welcome to the Cloud Magica. We are in third session of module 2. In previous session of module 2, we have discussed about where Hadoop can be used, Hadoop master slave architecture, Hadoop components, what is SDFS, key concepts related to SDFS, Hadoop cluster, Hadoop workflow, and now discuss about SDFS write operation. SDFS write operation belongs to the file creation. SDFS does not support file updates, but that is not completely true because we have something called file append feature in Hadoop, but it is not recommended for general purpose client use. Let us discuss something about the SDFS write process. Assume you have refund.txt file and size is 300 MB. And the client breaks refund.txt into three blocks. Block A, block B, and block C. Block A size will be 128 MB, block B size is equal to 128 MB, and block C size is equal to 44 MB. Simply we can say that Hadoop cluster is useless until it has data. So first, let's learn something about the loading the data to HDFS or writing file to SDFS. We will load refund.txt into the cluster for the processing purpose. Here we have goal for faster parallel processing of lots of data. To achieve that, definitely we need as many machines as possible working on this data all at once. So basically before storing, the client is going to break the data file into smaller chunks and place those chunks or block on different machines throughout the cluster. The rule is more block I have, the more machines I need to store it and multiple machines will be able to work on this data in parallel. We know Hadoop works on commodity hardware, so any slave node can fail at any moment of time. So we have to make ensure that every data block is available on multiple machines at once to avoid the data loss. So each block will be replicated when it is loaded into the cluster. Default replication factor is 3. So we will be having 3 copies of each block in the cluster. Default replication factor is 3, so we will be having 3 copies of each block in the cluster. Of course, we can change the configuration with the dfs.replication parameter in the file hdfs-site.xml. The client will interact with the name node and get a list of 3 data nodes where all copy of same block is present. We know that default replication factor is 3. For each block, the client will interact with the name node and get a list of 3 data nodes that should have a copy of this block. The client will then write the block directly to the data node. The receiving data node is responsible to replicate the block to other data nodes, and the cycle will repeat for all the remaining blocks. Name node will simply provide the map of where data is present and where data should go in the cluster. The name node is having only metadata and will not participate for the replication. So, writing to HDFS step by step. The client is ready to load refund.txt into the cluster. Client breaks the refund.txt into 3 blocks, block A, block B, and block C. Because block size is 300 MB and default block size is 128 MB, client will start with first block, which is block A. The client need to write block A on 3 different nodes because default block size is 3. So client is requesting need to write block A of refund.txt. Let's contact name node. The client will consult the name node stating that I want to write refund.txt and I need permission for that. The name node uses its rack awareness concept to take the decision that where these data will get stored. Name node will return the list of data nodes where client can write the block. It tells, okay, write to data node 1, data node 8, and data node 9. Basically, client receives a list of 3 data nodes for each block, a unique list for each block. The key rule is that for every block of data, 2 copies will exist in one rack, another copy will be in different rack. Before the client writes block A of refund.txt to the any data node of cluster, client wanted to know that all data nodes which are expected to have a copy of this block are ready to receive it or not. In this example, data node 1 of rack 1 is the first data node. Client picks the first data node in the list for block A, opens a TCP connection and inform to get ready to receive a block and take list of another data nodes. Data node 8, and data node 9 and contact them and make sure they are ready to receive these blocks too. Now data node 1 will open a TCP connection to data node 8. And says, hey, now get ready to receive a block and also make sure data node 9 is also ready to receive this block too. Now data node 8 will ask to data node 9, hey, are you ready to receive a block? In next step, data node 9 will reply back to data node 8 stating that I am ready to receive the block. Data node 8 will reply back to node 1 stating that I am ready to receive the block, and then data node 1 will reply back to client stating that I am ready to receive the block. Now the client is ready to begin writing blocks data into the cluster. So I hope this diagram is clear to you. If you have any doubt, just mail us. Writing to HDFS replication pipeline, data for each block should be written to the three data node in the cluster. So a replication pipeline is created between the three data nodes. I have already told you that we can change the replication factor in DFS dot replication. Data node 1 will start receiving block A and at the same time push a copy of the data to the next node in the pipeline, that is node 8 on rack 3. I have already explained you that rule is first replica on one node in the local rack, second replica on the different node in the different rack, third replica on the different node but same rack as second replica. Here you can observe that the second and third data node in the pipeline will be in the same rack. The next block will not be start until block A is successfully written to all three nodes. Success report for HDFS pipeline write. Pipeline write started from data node 1 and then data node 1 to data node 8, data node 8 to data node 9. Once all three nodes, data node 1, data node 8 and data node 9 have successfully received the block A, then they will send the success message to the pipeline. Means data node 9 will send report to data node 8. Data node 8 will send the report to data node 1. Data node 1 will inform client for the success write. All communication will happen through switch only. But to keep image simple, in most of the images, I am not showing the arrow through switch. all three nodes will send a success block received report to name node. Once the client receives a success message and tells the name node the block was successfully written, the name node updates its metadata info with the node locations of block A of refund.txt. After successful storing of block A, the client is ready to start the pipeline process again for the next block of data, that is block B. HDFS multiple block replication pipeline. The initial node in the pipeline will be different for each block. I would like to say block A will start writing from data node 1 of rack 1. Block B can start writing from data node 2 of rack 4, and block C can start writing from data node 1 of rack 5. You can see for block A, one copy is present in rack 1 and two copy is present in rack 5. For block B, one copy is present in rack 5 and two copy are present in rack 4. In similar way, for block C, one copy is present in rack 4 and another two copy are present in rack 1. Hadoop store and works on use data. It means Hadoop will also use a lot of network bandwidth and lot of storage capacity. We are typically dealing with very big files, maybe terabytes or petabytes in size. And each file will be replicated onto the network and disk 3 times because we have default replication factor 3. Of course, we can change that. If you have a 5 terabyte file, then it will consume 15 terabyte of network traffic to successfully load the file and 15 terabyte disk space to hold the file. But in reality, we will need more storage to store 15 GB of data because we keep some reserve space for operating system and some space for intermediate space. We will see later on that how much space we need to store 15 terabyte of data. So basically, file is distributed in pieces of blocks across the entire cluster of machines. Each machine having a relatively small part of the data. If we have huge file, then we will have more machines to store the files. So, if we have more blocks, then the more machines are required. Revision. What we have learned in HDFS write operation. It is very important to learn about this write operation so that let's revise and understand it in detail. And in some other way, the client is having some new file to write to SDFS. So before contacting the name node, the client will start streaming the contents of the file to a temporary file in its local file system. Once data size reaches the size of a block, the client contacts the name node. The name node now creates a space in the HDFS file system hierarchy and informs the client about the location of the data node where client can write the block. Name node basically returns the list of data nodes where block replication should be done. The client uses the information provided from name node to store the temporary file to the first data node received from the name node. The basically results in the actual file creation of an actual file on the local storage of the data node. So basically, once the first data node receives the data from the client in smaller packets, data is being written to the disk on the first data node. It starts streaming to the second data node. The second data node immediately starts writing the streaming data block to its own disk and at the same time starts streaming the data blocks to the third data node. The third data node now writes data to its own disk. Now data is written and replicated through our data nodes in the pipeline manner. So acknowledgement will be sent back from each data node to the previous one in the pipeline. The first data node sends the acknowledgement to the client. Once the client receives the acknowledgement for a data block, the block is assumed to be persisted to all the data nodes and it sends the final acknowledgement to the name node. While writing, if any data node in the pipeline fails, the pipeline will get closed. The data will still be written to the remaining data nodes, but we have good news that the name node will be aware that the file is under replicated and takes appropriate action to re-replicate the data on another data node to maintain the replication factor. A checksum will be computed for each block. Which is basically used to verify the integrity of the block. These checksums are basically stored in a separate hidden file in the HDFS and are basically used to verify the integrity of the block data when it is read back. Re-replicating missing replicas. Once the name node stops getting the heartbeat from a data node, then name node will assume that the particular data node is dead and any data which was present on that node gone as well. Based on the last reports which was received from the dead node, the name node come to know that which data block lost along with the data node, and on the basis of that, name node takes the decision to re-replicate those missing blocks to other data nodes. Name node will use the rack awareness concept to maintain replica rule that the two copies in one rack and one copy in another rack. So name node will decide as per replica rule that which data node will receive a new copy of blocks and from where. Assume node number 400 went down. So name node will analyze the previous block report sent by node 400 and identifies that block A and block E is missing. So to maintain the replica rule, only one more copy is needed. Name node uses the rack awareness concept and finds that missing block A can be placed on data node 800 of rack 9 and block E can be placed on data node 801 of rack 9. Assume a situation when an entire rack 5 of server goes down. The name node will use the concept of rack awareness and start instructing the remaining slave nodes in the cluster to re-replicate all of the data blocks lost in rack 5. Suppose this rack 5 was having 50 terabyte of data, then again 50 terabyte of data will travel across the network and consume the bandwidth. But this concept saves our precious data. Hadoop is made for write once and read many times. So suppose a client wants to read or retrieve a file from HDFS. So client will consult the name node and ask for the block location of the file. The name node will use the concept of rack awareness and return the list of each data node holding a block. For each block, just assume block A is present on data node 1, data node 3 and data node 10. Block B present on data node 3, data node 9 and data node 11. And block C is present on data node 5, data node 6 and data node 12. The client picks first data node from each list of block A and read one block at a time. It means it will pick data node 1 for block A, data node 3 for block B, data node 5 for block C. Once it finishes with one block, it moves to another block and it does not progress to the next block until the previous block completes. one slave node can interact with another slave node. In other words, one data node can interact with another data node. But what can be a scenario when data node should read some data blocks from another data node? Assume a scenario where data node has to process some data and that is not available locally. So no choice before it can begin processing. It must have to retrieve the data from another data node over the network. When the data node needs a block which is not available locally, then data node requests the name node for the location of block data. The name node will use RAG awareness concept and check if another data node in the same RAG has the data. If data is available in local RAG, then the name node provides the in RAG location from which data node can retrieve the data. In this case, transfer of data will happen within the switch, and data flow does not need to traverse through more switches. Data retrieval can be quicker in RAG because data node inside a switch can be connected via directly LAN. The data processing can begin sooner and the job can be completed much faster. As the block is being read, the checksum must be calculated while reading. Checksum must be calculated with the checksum calculated at the time of file write. If the checksum fails, the block can be retrieved from the replica. Just see the image where in rack 1 we have to process something on red colored node, node 3 and node 7, and data is not available there. So node 3 will copy the data from node 1 where data is available in same rack, that is rack 1, and data node 7 will copy the data from data node 9 of rack 3 because data is not present in same rack. So mechanism of an SDFS delete. There is nothing much to discuss about the SDFS delete. The name node only rename the file path to indicate that the file is moved into the trash directory. Delete operation is only metadata update operation. linked to renaming the file path. This is an extremely very fast process. The file stays in the trash directory for a predefined interval of time. 6 hours is the current setting, and during this time, the file can be restored easily by moving it from the trash directory. Once the time interval for which the file should be maintained in the trash directory expires, the name node deletes the file from the HDFS namespace. The blocks making up the deleted file are freed up, and the system shows an increased available space. So I hope you have enjoyed the module 2. Thanks for watching. Have a good day.